And we're expecting a few more people, but we will start on time so that we finish on time. And hopefully those who, the late arrivals, will just join us. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. I begin first and foremost by welcoming you and acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which we stand, and pay my respect to their elders, past, present, and those who come, those to come. And we acknowledge the tremendous contributions of the first peoples of this land, their contributions to the heritage, to the culture, to the civilization, and to the spiritual aspects of this most wonderful land of ours. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Muhammad Abdullah. For those who don't know me, I am the director, I forgot what I was. I'm the director of the Center for Islamic Thought and Education. The Center for Islamic Thought and Education was established in August 2016, so it's a recently established center. It's almost a year and a half, in fact. In August this year, we'll be 2 years old. However, within the last year and a half, we have managed to attain and succeed in a number of things. So, for example, we have now 20 PhD students. In a year and a half, we have managed to attract 20 PhD students. And I received a call today from the HDR office saying we have to put a hold on your PhD applications because of space. So we have to start looking for space. I was going to suggest that they pitch some tents outside and just put them in tents, but I don't think that would have been taken favorably. So the Center for Islamic Thought also has now 6 or 7 academic staff, plus a center manager, Ramila, who graciously helped in organizing this, and of course our PA and admin officer, Jen Manning. We have also a host of adjunct professors and associate professors from across the world, from Oman, from Qatar, from Malaysia, from Indonesia, from Saudi, and elsewhere, all who have various specializations within the realm of the vision of the Center for Islamic Thought and Education. And our research focuses on a number of areas: Islamic finance, of course, cryptocurrencies, Islamic education, Islamic civilization, domestic violence, strengthening family relations, and leadership and management, among a host of other things. And these lectures are monthly lectures where we try to tackle some issues of importance and significance. And today's lecture is on the very significant and timely topic of cryptocurrencies, or bitcoins, from obscure curiosity to future money. Of course, Dr. Mahmood Nathie always comes up with these wonderful titles, and his presentations are even more wonderful. Dr. Nathie needs no introduction for those who know him. He's a leading scholar in Islamic finance, but in finance generally. And he has contributed tremendously to the field. In Australia, he's perhaps one of the leading scholars in the field of Islamic finance and banking, but also with a background in finance generally. And I have known Dr. Nathie, I had the pleasure of knowing him for at least the last 25 years. I don't know if he thinks that's good or bad, but I think it's good. And today's topic is going to shed light on the very important and timely issue of bitcoins, or cryptocurrencies, not only what it is and how it emerged and where the heck it came from, but also from a Sharia perspective, from an Islamic law perspective, how is it seen? How is it something that is encouraged? Is it lawful? Is it unlawful? Why and why not? This is the topic of tonight's lecture. I am definitely sure you will enjoy it. But also you will end up with some headache because of the technicalities that will be used. But Dr. Nathie is good at simplifying things. And I encourage you all to ask the questions. So are you doing half an hour presentation? Or what are you looking
for? I think it'll go beyond half an hour.
So we'll give him 40 minutes, no more. After 40 minutes, I will exercise my authority and stop him. And then we will open the floor for question and answer for 20 minutes. So 1 hour in total. And Jen Manning standing there. If I can't stop him, we will ask Jen and Ramila to come along, and three of us will try to stop you after 40 minutes. Does that sound fair? All right, thank you very much. And without further ado, please welcome Dr. Nathie.
Thank you for the very threatening introduction. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's on. It's on. It's on. We can hear you.
Can you?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for gracing this lecture today or tonight. I want to start off by acknowledging the Ghana people who are the first people of this country. And with that, let me start off because time is. So,
turn it on.
It's on, but.
No, click on. I think you need to check your mic.
I think it's just in the wrong place. It's on, but you have to speak a bit louder.
If that's not working, just can you use this one then?
So much for technology. Well, thank you very much. Before I commence, these are my references, so I'm not, haven't pulled anything from the sky. I have just listed some of the references here to make sure that I'm not called up at any time to say, well, this is all your ideas. Well, yes, but I've also consulted all these authors. Think. Now, money in a digital age is something that is that is not new. We know money traditionally as money being in a form of precious metals, gold and silver. But in this age, money has taken a new perspective, and we're going to cover a lot of this in tonight's lecture. We're going to cover what is money, then move on to blockchain and digital currencies, the risks and dangers associated with it, look at the stock market bubbles, currency debasements, and towards the end, I will give you some idea of the Sharia perspectives on cryptocurrencies. Here is a professor from Berkeley in California, and this is what he says, that we're in the grip of social phenomena that we've never experienced, and people are paying thousands of dollars for something that is essentially a reward for playing a computer game. Whether you agree with it or not, this is what the respective professor is saying. It has no physical properties, it's questionable, there's no regulation, and it only exists with a sufficient number of people and computers, to say the least. Does it qualify as money? Well, we'll find out later. May already qualify as the greatest asset bubble in recorded history, and I will go through some of the bubbles. Modern money has been defined as something that is indispensable and a social convention, meaning that it is only a means towards ensuring that there is counter value in transactions that you undertake. In other words, if I sell you a watch, then you've got to give me something back. The counter value is money. What that money is, in times going by, it could be, let's say, seashells or some other forms, and I'll show you later. So it is a convention because when its use becomes very common, people then recognize that as the common denominator, something that is associated with passing value, and we call that counter value. Modern money is something that must be backed by a accountable institution, normally a central bank, and in Australia, the Reserve Bank of Australia does just that. It is the issuer of currencies. It is also the banker of the banks and the banker of the government. And all money issues then flows through it. They set monetary policies, and then they in turn expect that banks and other institutions will filter down all these policies and become the norm in society then. But one of the essential characteristics of a central bank is to ensure that there is trust in the currency, because if a currency does not have any trust, it will debase, it will fall. In 2008, the Zimbabwean dollar fell to such an extent that to buy a packet of cigarettes, for example, you had to go with about 25 billion Zimbabwe dollars. I mean, the paper on which it was printed was more expensive than the current sale. So the intrinsic value was not even only useless, but worthless. Call it whatever you want to. So the intervention of the central bank there was very essential to make sure that people can buy ordinary things, goods, food, and so forth. But if the currency does not have any value, how will a person who's, let's say, a baker, give me bread if I can't give him counter value in money? Very difficult. So we say that the characteristics of money is that it must be something that is widely accepted, it must be reliable, and it must be stable. This idea of stability is with us all the time, as we'll notice every time the Australian dollar falls or rises, you'll see the price is immediately affected in the price of fuel. Why that is so, of course, is a lengthy explanation, but I'm not going to get into that. The point here is that if you had a stable currency, then that stable currency would ensure that the price of fuel would be, let's say, a dollar for the next 10 or 15 years. That is not the case. But to have stability requires an institution, and that institution itself must be stable. And one of the ideas of a currency is that it avoids what you call double coincidence. In days gone by, when people only had the barter system, you could go to a person and say, you know what, I need bread, and I'll sell you shoes. But it's not always the case that a baker would want shoes, or where the shoemaker wants bread. So the only way they could transact was to have a medium of exchange, and that medium of exchange is money. Here, you'll see there are different types of money. What is money? Money in some societies were yapstones, and then shortly after World War I, in Germany, things got so bad that the Germans used to trade German marks for American cigarettes because they considered cigarettes as more worthwhile or more worthy or more trustworthy, and that was a common medium of exchange. And then, of course, we had this ridiculous situation shortly after the First World War, where the Americans attracted so much money from the war-torn countries of Europe that they had to issue huge currencies to ensure that their currency itself was stable. Of course, at that time, the American currency was backed by gold, as it was in the years before then. In approximately 1861, when the British adopted the gold standard, all pounds that were issued in Britain were backed by gold. In other words, you could take a pound and go to the Reserve Bank of the Bank of England and say, look, I demand that you give me a piece of gold which is represented by this pound. In fact, the same situation occurred here in Australia too. I think it was, I'm not sure about the date, but somewhere in the 70s, you still had on the notes written there that you can encash this at the Reserve Bank, and the Reserve Bank was obliged to convert this money to you. So money had value at that time. Comes 1971, and Mr. Nixon says, well, you know what, we don't have enough gold. We're not going to back it by gold anymore because we don't have gold. And so the gold standard was removed, and the American dollar then was unpegged from gold. In other words, it became just another currency, and its worth was the worth of the paper it was written on. Of course, we must understand that the strength of the economy of a country also determines the value of the currency of that country. It is not merely to say that, well, I have a dollar here and the dollar is worthless. No, it has worth because the country has made it worth. Here is, I provide a taxonomy of the, and it's called a money flower. And I must acknowledge that this I've taken from Beck and Garrett, who are two researchers at the Bank for International Settlements in Geneva. And they've come up with this money diagram. This is called a Venn diagram. A Venn diagram is diagrams that intersect each other, and they have relationships to each other. So you see, from the, starting from the left, we say that money must be universally accessible through cash, commodity, currency, or whatever. It can be in the form of electronic. It must have a central bank that is a hold of reserve, and it can be transacted peer-to-peer from people to people, from organization to organization. What this means is that cryptocurrencies as such, as we know it, is not new. This has been going on for quite a while. Because in the old days when you only had credit cards, think about it, the credit cards represented money. We only required to present a credit card to be able to transact transactions. So this was one form of money. Today, let's see how this has manifested itself. Coles, Woolies, McDonald's, all these organizations are using cryptocurrencies in a sense that if you transact with them, you don't have need to go with physical money. You give your card, and they will then remove or they will debit your account at your bank. But the difference is that Coles and Woolies and all these organizations requires a central authority to be able to transact or to monitor or to regulate all the transactions. In other words, UniSA, if you were a non-student and you want to access information for UniSA, you just can't simply go on there and say, right, I want to access the library, for example. You need to go in and log in with your name and your passwords and so forth. So this is also a form of peer-to-peer electronic system. Here, I've extended this flower here, and in particular, unfortunately this doesn't work, the area that you have to look at is the gray area here and these two areas here. You can see that where all these elliptical circles intersect, we have all these coins that are now new to the cryptocurrency market. It is the same as this flower that we had before, except that now we've incorporated many, many more forms of electronic payments. M-Pesa, and those who are in Africa will know what I'm referring to, M-Pesa. It is a unique form of money transfer where you can transfer your money on your phone. You buy credit, and you can send it to your friend or your mother or your daughter somewhere in Somalia, and they will go to a place and just encash it. So this is also a form of cryptocurrency. Then we come to Bitcoin. Does Bitcoin fit into the flower? Of course it does, because it's been there before. It's not something new, except that Bitcoin works on the principle that there is no central authority. Whereas in Australia, we have the Reserve Bank that is a central authority, cryptocurrencies does not have a central authority. It is purely peer-to-peer. There may be a million people in the chain, and we'll call it for now, let's say, the blockchain. I don't know whether you're in the blockchain, neither do you know if all the others are in the blockchain, because our identity is anonymous. Where does this idea of anonymity come in? You see, if you were to give everybody cash and you transact with cash, that's also anonymous. Nobody knows how much cash you have in your pocket. The same principle applies with cryptocurrencies, that when you transact electronically, the counterparty does not know who you are and probably doesn't care who you are, as long as they get their counter value. So in this picture here, have a look at all these characters here. None of them faces you. That's because, I mean, from an artistic point of view, it's faceless. The cryptocurrency is a faceless and it's an anonymous transaction tool. So here are people there that go to the extent of making cryptocurrency something like a god, praying to it, or making it such, or elevating it to a status where it shouldn't really be elevated. The point here is that cryptocurrencies has now entered the market. It uses the blockchain, and the blockchain is peer-to-peer, that's P2P. No one owns DLT, by the way, is distributed ledger technology. When we transact, let's for argument's sake, that all of us are part of this distributed ledger technology. If we commence this distributive technology, none of us will know who each other are, because we will be given an encrypted identity. And as we transact with each other, at the end of the day or the end of the month, we will know between ourselves who owes someone else what amount. In this case, the amount will be in bitcoins. But as opposed to the central bank, where the Australian banks have by law, by 9 p.m. every evening, they have to clear all the transactions. They have to send all the transactions to the central bank. And by 9 o'clock every evening, if ANZ Bank owes Commonwealth Bank, let's say, $50 million, they have to settle each other. That is why sometimes, at certain critical time of the evening, you won't notice it, but in the background, the transactions are being cleared. And therefore, sometimes it is very difficult to clear transactions. That is why some banks will tell you, if it's overnight, it will only reflect next day or probably the day thereafter. What you don't know is what's happening at the back. Behind there is their association with the central bank. Then we say that Bitcoins is a system that is dependent on blockchain technology. Anyone can access it. Fraudsters, crooks, blackmailers, whoever it is, because it is anonymous. And by the way, this is one of the biggest problems that is associated with cryptocurrencies and with Bitcoin especially, because a lot of the countries in the world are now saying that tax evasion has become very prominent because people are using all these means to bypass the regulatory environment. And one of its other properties is that it cuts out intermediaries. You don't have to have a central bank to clear all your transactions because it's peer-to-peer. And of course, but it is a very, very expensive operation because it requires enormous computing power. And that can be very, very expensive. There are studies being done today, and one study I read was the present consumption of power only for powering Bitcoin is equivalent to the total energy used by Singapore per day.
Wow.
Every day. Now, if you think that's horrible, there are other studies that show that the total computing energy that is required to power Bitcoin is equivalent to the power required of Iceland to run its whole country. So, a professor from Queensland University has done some study, Professor Quiggan, and he says that 10 years from now, we will have to build so many power stations that this idea of, you know, an environmentally friendly power and so forth will just fly out of the window. There'll be no such thing anymore because we'll require so much power to power the technology. Now I ask you, is that an efficient way of transacting? Is that a property of money? Definitely not. Why should you pay for money when money is meant to pay for something else? Here is a graph of how Bitcoin works. I'm not going to go through each one of this, but you can see that it very aptly shows as miners there. Bitcoins are generated by a mathematical formula or an algorithm. And it started in 2009 with 50 coins. And then anyone who wants to enter the Bitcoin organization, if I may call it this, has to mine. And that comes with requiring huge amount of computing power. And as soon as you enter your details, you are given an encrypted code. And then you go in and you have to start mining. And at the end of that process, you are rewarded with one Bitcoin. Now, the analogy they use is that, well, if you want gold, you'll have to go into a mine and dig the gold. That is value. But the difference is that if you're running a gold mine, you have to employ people. So gold mines employ people. Gold mines are efficient because they employ people. And gold is a commodity that is required or preferred by many, many people. So we see in this diagram here that Bitcoin works with a blockchain and it can effectively ensure payments between people. Even buying a cup of coffee, not that I used it before, but I'm pretty sure that there's not many stores today that accept Bitcoins. And for the simple reason that the clearing mechanism is very difficult, number one, and number two, it's very expensive in terms of bank charges. Ultimately, if you're sitting with two or five Bitcoins, and you try and encash it in some countries, in Japan, for instance, there was a study done that 40% of a Bitcoin's value only disappeared in bank charges. So it is very, very uneconomical in that sense. Of course, what people are conflating all the time is a concept of blockchain, which is a totally perfect and understandable and workable technology, and conflating it with Bitcoin. Bitcoin is only a money that is created. The technology that runs in is blockchain. So many people would argue with you, well, you know what, blockchain is very reliable, and as a result of the reliability, we then can depend on blockchain as being a reliable currency. But that does not answer the question. The question is that, is blockchain or is Bitcoin a currency? Clearly, in my opinion, it lacks some of the essential qualities of a coin. Here I'm saying that there is a transformative process between sovereign money. Sovereign money is the money that we know that is issued by a central bank, and money which is alt money, alternative money. Digitization is not new, as we've seen in the diagrams before. And in the flower that I show you, Bitcoins is just an extension of the type of coinage that is being used. In Sweden, for example, the authorities there are in the process of changing the whole economy to a cashless economy. They are almost 90% there. An article that I read night before last says that if you go to any shop or any place in Sweden, nobody will accept money. Nobody will accept money. They only accept a card or accept any type of electronic payment. In the two countries that are experimenting with cryptocurrencies at the central bank level is Singapore and Canada. They have not adopted the cryptocurrency formula yet, because one of the problems with central banks adopting a cryptocurrency is because essentially a central bank only deals with banks, not with non-banks like people like us. And so it is essential that if you're going to include people in this whole chain, that you must ensure that there are proper securities and safeguards to make sure that the wrong people do not enter the chain and exploit the chain. Is Bitcoin good money? Well, it's a question that's on everybody's lip. Is it money at all? Some would say it is, other would say no. But historically, if we look at what happened to the Greeks, they had the Greek coin in the time of the Greek Empire, isn't it? Just forgotten the name of the Greek Empire. And they used to mint coins, and the coins had a certain value, and that value was determined by the gold content. However, as Greece and later Rome expanded, and they needed more and more money for their war effort, they started shaving the value of the money. Shaving means that instead of, let's say, 1 gram of gold, they made it 0.9 gram of gold, and the other 0.1 was silver. Now, as time passed, the bimetallic proportion was skewed in favor of silver. In other words, there was more silver and less gold. So you can see that was the first process of the debasement of a currency, where we had a currency which depended on the value of gold. Now the value of that gold was diminished. And during the time of the Mamluks,
If you had to go and transaction with someone in Egypt, it is possible that you would have to go to an SAS. An SAS is a person who determines the gold content. He does SAing. And they had to take it to an SAS to determine value, the gold content, to be able to transact. So you can see the problems that had already occurred there. Now, consider this. Suppose 10 years from now, we have 200,000 bitcoins in the market. What would happen? The same principle applies, is that the value of cryptocurrencies will then be flooded. And if you flood the market, whether it's with physical money or whether it's with electronic money, is going to lead to inflation. And it soon the inflation will lead to hyperinflation, as we've seen in Venezuela today, where to buy a loaf of bread in Venezuela today, you have to take, I think, about 500,000 local currency just to buy bread. So this is what happens when you have too much money entering the economy. Of course, everybody would know that in Germany, during the Weimar Republic, this is shortly after the Second World War, before the Second World War, the Germans were in the quandary because they owed a lot of money to the French and the English, and so they debased their currency to pay their war debts. If money is to be considered as good, then it must withstand currency crisis. And with Bitcoin, unfortunately, we don't have enough history to be able to say with confidence that it can withstand a currency crisis. What is the process of financial crisis? It begins with a burst of optimism, as we see with Bitcoins. Everybody say, well, you know what, buy Bitcoins, it's a good investment. Followed by loose credit from the banks, if the banks will give you the money, that is. And I know some people that has actually mortgaged their houses, get the money and put it into Bitcoins. That leads to an investor hysteria, and that leads to a sudden financial failure. And as soon as you see a failure, people want to liquidate, people want to cash up. And that is where you see a mess exodus from that market. Let's look at what happened to the price of Bitcoin. Until there's a way for a cryptocurrency to price a cryptocurrency, its price will be set by speculative bets, which is precisely what is happening here. And I'll show you in these graphs here. Have a look at these graphs here. There are three bubbles that we've identified with associated with Bitcoins. In the first one, you can see, starting from 2010, shortly after 2009 when you were introduced, you see that it peaked and then it fell off very sharply. 2013, the same thing happened there, but see the values? The values are different there. We start off, the base values are different there. And then more recently, 2015, every peak has been followed by a very sudden crash. And here is a graph that shows you the future trend. And you can expect from here on that the price of Bitcoin currency is going to fall progressively. So we say that when will be the next fall? Well, we don't know. Watch the derivatives market. Why? Because here, you know the big banks and the big institutions. They're very, very clever. When they want to make money, they use the derivatives market. Now, let me explain something. Here, Bitcoin was doing very well until December last year, and then something happened. The American regulatory authorities introduced or allowed derivatives trading. Derivatives trading means you sell something that you don't have. It doesn't make sense, but that is what I call it, short selling. You sell something that you don't have. In other words, I sell you a watch, but I don't have the watch. So as soon as you say, okay, I'll buy the watch, what I do then is I go and buy the watch. But I then take advantage of price drops. The opposite is taking advantage of price rises. So here, the wild card here is when they introduce the futures market. The Chicago Board of Options Trading introduced options trading. Now, options trading works like this. If you have, let's say this is a price of something and this is the period time. If you buy, let's say, an asset that is worth, let's say the Telstra share is $3.10 today. If you go to a trader, the trader will say, okay, I will sell you a put option. A put option is you're selling something that you don't have. The opposite is a call option, is to buy something you have the right to buy or to sell without the obligation to buy or to sell. So in other words, you have two outcomes. If the price increases above $3.10, then you will be profit. Then you may be making profit. If the price drops there, then you'll be making a loss. But then you take your bets two ways. You buy a put and you buy a call option. When that happens, the two cancels each other out. So what happened in America was people that were buying physical bitcoins did not require to buy bitcoins anymore because they went on to the futures market and they started trading on the futures market and that just collapsed the whole futures, the whole market for bitcoins. Here is a concept that I discussed earlier, debasement. What is forking? Forking is, if you understand forking, let's just think of a fork like this. What happens is that you take one Bitcoin, and you divide it into hundreds, probably thousands, probably millions of smaller Bitcoins, right? So what is the difference between forking and reducing the content of a currency? You're just flooding the market with useless currency. That's exactly what will happen. Today, we have about 19 million, I think, Bitcoins in circulation. A time will come when those 19 million Bitcoins will be divided into 19 billion and probably 19 trillion Bitcoins. Think about it. What would the value of the Bitcoin be in 5 years from now if there's 15 or 20 trillion of those in circulation? Its value will be useless. So Bitcoin, one of the disadvantages is that it can debase the currency and it can destroy a nation's economy. So here, the process has already started because in 2017, we already had 19 Bitcoin forks. Those who are active in trading Bitcoins will know. Now you have Bitcoin Cash, Bitcoin Gold, Bitcoin Diamond, Bitcoin Diamond. I don't know. You know, we can go on and on and on. What are you really buying? You don't know what you're buying really because the original Bitcoin is so scarce, nobody wants to sell it. So yeah, we say that money to be a tangible thing or to have trust in money takes years to build, but it takes seconds to break. And Bitcoin has no liability. That means that if something happens, you cannot go to a third party and claim. If something happens to the Australian dollar today, you know, we all have security, we have insurance. All of us have money insurance. If something happens to Commonwealth Bank or ANZ Bank or any of the banks, that insurance will cover the potential loss of the failure of those banks. It doesn't apply in cryptocurrencies. Here's something, debasement. I like this one here. The Americans. But here, look here. That note over there says that 500 million papier mark. It's German. Papier is paper, paper marks. And this, the commissioner of German's currency say that it was trading about 500 million eggs for the one valuable currency that it had to represent. Now, what would happen if the world was flooded with cryptocurrency and money supply is out of control? That is one of the consequences, but we really don't know. So, here's a quiz for you. Suppose you have 100,000 to invest. And you have the following choices: 100,000 in Bitcoin, 100,000 in physical coin, half in each, 100,000 in stocks, or 100 in diversified portfolio. Which one do you think you'll choose?
Diversified.
Eh?
Diversified.
We'll diversify. Why?
To diversify your risk.
Right, you're spreading your risk, isn't it?
To minimize.
Yeah. But if you into one currency, this is a problem, you can't diversify. And when the crash comes, when the crunch comes, the possibility is that you can lose all your money. Before answering, you have to consider the risk, diversification, and liquidity. Liquidity means the ability to take your investments and turn it into cash, hard cash. But if you don't, if you have a situation someday where you don't have hard cash, what are you going to convert it into? That's one of the problems. Behavioral finance gives us some idea of why we behave the way we behave and why people take bets. Here are some of the typical behavior associated with investment. Loss aversion. Loss means that, well, you say to yourself, you know what, I lost $10,000, okay, so I'm going to accept it. But I'm going to take a chance and see if I can recover that money again. Loss aversion means that you're not taking into account the loss to your real wealth. You're just writing it off mentally and say, you know what, okay, it's a one-off thing, but it's not. Then selling winners before you, and you're holding on to losers. This is especially true in stock market trading. People have the tendency to sell all the good shares first and then hold on to the lousy shares. But you should do the opposite. Sell the bad ones first and hold on to the good ones. Impulsiveness is what happens often in the economy. Yeah, you know, A and B are buying Bitcoin, C and D are buying this other coin, Ethereum or something else. And well, why can't I get into the act? Impulsive. You're not taking into account your own personal circumstances. And then herd mentality is following a herd, you know, with cows and with the animals. The first one is always the leader. And if the leader goes in the wrong way, the whole herd will follow. You see it in all these David Attenborough's, you know, films where you see the herd of these animals trying to cross the river. It's always the first one that will make the decision. And it's always the first person that will invest in Bitcoin. But the first person that invested in Bitcoin was a person who's making the most money. So what is the difference between that and a pyramid scheme or a Ponzi scheme? Not very much different, because if you're early in the game, you make the money. If you come late in the game, sorry, you're going to lose out. And then there's a gambler's fallacy. You know, a gambler always says, oh, I lost $10. Never mind. I'll put another $50 and I'll try and recover 50 and make up for the 10. But you don't often. So these are some of the behavioral aspects of a person's constitution that allows him or her to make financial decisions. And often these decisions are not rational. Here is a list of all the people that are involved in buying bitcoins. Satoshi Nakamoto, nobody knows who he is, whether he's a Japanese, whether he's a French, whoever he is, but he's made a lot of money, I'll tell you, because he's sitting pretty with that. Take, for example, gamblers and speculation. They are there just to get rich very quickly. And they are usually traders who hold short positions or long positions. They are the ones that propel price. So these are the ones that are really setting the market price. Then we have, and this is for those who don't understand the Islamic principles, wealth is a trust that God has given you, and you are expected to look after the trust. Because if you don't look after the trust, it will invariably diminish your wealth. And for something that you want to leave for your offspring. Now, it says that then, on that day, you shall most certainly be questioned about the bounties that God has given you, meaning that on the day of judgment, you will be held accountable for your wealth. And then the Prophet ﷺ said that God has exalted and made sacred your lives, your wealth, and your honor. And then there's a very famous hadith that says that five things will be put to a person on the day of judgment, two of which refers to wealth, about his wealth, how he earned it, and how did he spend his wealth. So take into consideration those principles there. And then I say that the Quran is not a book on economics. It never was. It is a book on ethics, philosophy, and so forth. The first argument that people advance in favor of bitcoins is that they say, some scholars say that it is property. Now, think about it. Is it really property in a true sense of the word? Is it tangible? It's not tangible. But they equate it to paper money, saying that paper money is equivalent to electronic money, therefore, by extension, that falls under the definition of mal. They rely on a depreciation by a very famous scholar who passed away about 4 years ago, Wahbal Zuhaili. He was a Syrian scholar, and he says that anything that is corporeal or has a usufruct or that which cannot be stored is considered mal, is considered a possession. Therefore, everything that can be possessed and is valuable is mal. So these two conditions must prevail, possession and value. So I cannot say that, you know, I've got, this is valuable if I don't have it. Neither can I say that it has value if you cannot place a value to it. Neither can you say that it has value if you value it in different currencies, because different currencies will give you different values. So these are some of the conditions that apply in Islamic law. Imam Shafi says that to be able to be classified as mal, it must have value. It must be used as a consideration in trade. That means it must be able to pass. It must be mobile. There must be counter value. A person must be compensated for when it is destroyed, and people must not regard it as valueless. Slight mistake there. The second argument is that possession of goods or what we call mal in Islamic law is something that is storable. It must be present and we must and it must have a permissible use. The third argument is urf or customary practice. To be able to define something as a currency, it must be something that is customary. In centuries gone by, people accepted seashells as currency because in that community, for that time, it was considered as some as having value and you could pass possession. You had counter value. So to the extent to which you have customary practice, to that extent we say that that coin or that currency is money. The fourth argument is that customary practices must be in vogue. You cannot just say Bitcoin is money because really, if you go to the corner shop here and say you want to buy a loaf of bread and you say, look, here's my Bitcoin, I'll probably look at you and throw you out of the shop. You know, what are you giving me? I don't know. This is not money. So it's not customary, not yet. Perhaps 10 years' time, when everybody will have all these millions of Bitcoins there, it may become customary, but then it's too late. So fiat money is the money that you and I possess. It is money that is printed by the three slides. It is money that is printed by the Reserve Bank. I would have shown you how money is created, but we are running short of time. The general rule in Islamic finance, the legal maxim is that all transactions are permissible except those that are expressly prohibited. The other rule is that harm must be eliminated. If I see that there is something that is going to affect your possession or your harm or your wealth, then I must remove it. It is a duty. It is an obligation. Now, this principle applies to government as well. The government, if the government notices that there is something there in the economy that will harm the wealth of people, then the government should step in and address that harm. So this is the principle that applies. Custom is the basis of judgment because anything that is customary, we know that selling goods on credit, selling goods on cash, and so forth, we've been acquainted with that form of transaction. That becomes customary. So we can, and then certainty is not overruled by doubt. This is a very important principle here. You cannot say that, oh, I will invest in something and I think it will have value, but you're doubtful about the value. The premise from which you start is that you start with certainty. You say that this has value because I consider it valuable. You can't say that I consider this valuable in 10 years' time. Whereas, you know, imagination is free. You can imagine anything. So you can imagine that 20 years from now, I don't know, maybe chairs will become money. Who knows? I'm not going to go through the counter arguments because there is not much time. But two things that I want to, principles that I want to focus on is the prohibition of uncertainties and the prohibition of gambling. Do you know that most of the transactions occurring on the options market today are speculative? And the authors say, it's not what I'm saying, but it is gambling. They take huge bets. For example, tonight, a fund in America will probably take a bet on the stock of Woolworths going down. And they'll buy probably 10 or 50 million Woolly shares. And even if those shares drop by 1 cent, they'll make money because they take advantage of what we call arbitrage, making use of information or making use of temporary gaps in the market to your advantage. And here are some of the fatwas or the rulings that are given by some of the famous scholars today. The Grand Mufti of Egypt said that it's illegal. The Turkish government has outlawed it. The Palestine Center said it has no central authorities. And Sheikh Haytham from the UK said that CCs are not backed by anything. It's not legal tender. It has no central authority. And it's prone to illegalities and money laundering. On the other hand, people are saying that it is permissible. It is based on a permissible of mal. And it is based on a legal maxim of permissibility that is treated as valuable. And it's accepted as a medium exchange. Of course, there's a lot of debate about that. But if you think that blockchain is more secure, consider this, that 2 years ago, the Bangladesh bank who had $1 billion invested in the Federal Reserve Bank of New York was swindled out of $1 billion electronically. So it's not that it is as secure as people say it is. And then, of course, this is the last slide here. There is this story of Joseph or Yusuf alayhi salam. Remember when he came back the second time with his brothers, and his father said, look, there's so many brothers of yours going to meet the Pharaoh. And he said, look, don't enter in by one gate. Enter by different gates, meaning spread your risk. Right? Spread your risk. Because there's a chance that all of you will be prosecuted or arrested. And then there is, you know, Umar radiallahu anhu, there was a time when he had gone on an expedition and a word came that plague broke out in that place. And he told his army, look, don't go there. And they said, Umar, you know, you're such a valiant person. And you're telling us not to enter this territory? He says, I'm telling you not to enter because there is harm there, and I'm trying to prevent you from harm. So this is where we get some of the principle of preventing harm. I think I've said enough. I'll leave it to my respected professor.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Nathie, for this wonderful presentation. I'm sure it has clarified many issues or confused you even more, right? But if it has clarified all of the issues, it means you don't have questions. If it has confused you, it means you have more questions. Now, we have some time for questions. I'm going to permit 10 minutes of Q&A, and I'm going to facilitate this session. So if you have a question, I'm going to pass the mic to you. I know I can hear you without the mic, but because we are recording these sessions, we want you to speak in the mic, please. Does anyone have any question to Dr. Nathie?
Free of charge.
Yeah, because if you don't ask, he will start asking you questions. Have you understood? Yes, please, Dr. Zafar.
Thanks, Brother Nathie. That was a very good presentation. So from what I have seen, you have said, and we can see that the Bitcoin or cryptocurrency would be used in the common market in, if not 5 years, maybe 10 years. And I think there's already some ATM cards or hard wallet as well for Bitcoin. So obviously, would that be halal now from your perspective? I know at the moment there's different fatwas and every person probably would make their own mind which one they want to follow. But obviously you have much more knowledge than we do. So from your perspective, if we just buy some Bitcoin now just for the sake that, you know, it might be useful later on, is it permissible? Or we should just wait till it is like the normal money which we have today, and then we obviously we won't make much profit, but then at least we'll be able to use it. The third thing is, if we don't invest initially and we just wait till all the new currencies are being used on a common day basis, then we would never be strong. So shall we just wait till the end? Is that what Sharia is telling us, or?
This is working, just bring it close to your mouth. Don't eat it, just bring it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, look, that's a very... It's a very interesting question, and I don't want to declare here whether it's halal or haram, because I'm not that much of a legal scholar to give you that. But this much I'll say, that I will advise you to avoid investing in bitcoins. And in the one slide that I showed there, I said, will you prefer to invest $100,000 in bitcoins, or will you prefer to invest it in gold? If you can answer that, then you're answering that question, because gold is tangible, gold is value, gold has been there for thousands of years. And you can use it, and you can store it there for another 1,000 or probably 10,000 years. It's not going to change. What I'm saying to you is that that fear and the danger of cryptocurrencies is that the fear of the unknown. One of the fear of the unknown is uncertainty. And Islamic law says that you should not indulge in anything that is highly uncertain. Gharar. I mean, the prohibition is very, very clear. The second point I want to make is that most of the transactions that's going on in the international money market and international finance market is driven by speculation. And you only need to read the financial papers and to read the authoritative books on finance to know that the thoughts of themselves say this is gambling. Only thing they say, well, it's an intelligent mode of gambling. I can't understand why. But do you know that the stock of American dollars in circulation, it's about $3 or $5 trillion. $1 trillion. But the bets that they've taken against the dollar is about 50 times the value of the dollar. The American Stock Exchange, if we value it at, let's say, $21 trillion to $25 trillion, the amount of derivatives that is being speculated against that market is $750 trillion. Can you imagine what will happen if, for some reason, the market collapses to such an extent that there is no value left of the stock? We'll all be this. I'm saying that, and I'll say that very clearly, there is no objection about the technicalities. The blockchain, there's nothing wrong with the blockchain, because we are using blockchain right now. But it is a concept that is, you know, that is used to produce money, which is a scary part of the blockchain. Because, let's say technically, all our lights fail in South Australia. It has failed.
It happened. It's not technical, so we had a problem.
Yeah. So what will happen? It's possible that you won't have trace, or your encryption will be wiped out. It's possible. I don't say it is will happen. I said it's possible. So these are some of the fears, inherent fears about cryptocurrencies.
Thank you for that. Any other questions?
I can go in at length in some of the debate. Yeah.
Thank you. Any other questions?
I have a question.
You can't ask yourself a question, so are you asking them a question?
Yeah. Now, how many people do you think are in the blockchain? Nobody knows, because it is so anonymous that even if you try to establish how big it is or how many people are in a blockchain, then you can imagine how you can plan the next round of cryptocurrencies. Now, what has happened today is that as we stand here today, there's over 2,000 different types of cryptocurrencies. I can't keep even track of some of the famous ones.
1,500.
1,500, others say it's 2,000, others say it's more. 5 years from now, I can see it growing at a rate of about 1,000, maybe 2,000 a year. You'll have 10,000. And then, let me ask you, which one will you prefer over the other one? Which one will be secure? Which one can you trust? So all these questions goes into making a thing acceptable or non-acceptable. That's why I don't want to say it's halal or haram. I'll say that stay away from it, because there are better alternatives. Why would people want to bet on something where the potential outcomes is very, very unpredictable, as opposed to something that you can hold or trade with, or something that is liquid?
Excellent. I think that's a good point to end with, and that is, all given that there is no definitive text in the sources of Sharia to say to us whether Bitcoin is halal or haram, you will come to varying responses as to whether it is halal or haram. However, if you were to take into account some of the principles and the maxims, the kulliyat, as it's called, if you take some of the principles and the maxims that we heard about of tonight, such as avoiding doubt and so forth, removal of harm and so forth, then it may be safe to say that to remain on the cautious side until such time that there is more clarity by the ulama or the scholars, the legal scholars, on this issue. I know you may have more questions, but I'm going to end the session, and you will have the opportunity to mingle and maybe ask Dr. Nathie privately any of your questions. Meanwhile, join me in thanking Dr. Nathie for this wonderful presentation. Sorry, your session is finished.
Our center will be holding a series of these lectures. I'm hoping to hold more
sessions.
Not on Bitcoin, but the next one on some other topic. So I'd like to see a good turnout. It won't cost you any money, but maybe we'll let.
Well, thank you for that. That was my next announcement. In fact, that site holds these monthly lectures. Of course, next month is May, and so it will be a fasting month. And so the next lecture will be in June, 21st of June. There are monthly lectures by all the academic staff who are part of site, and sometimes we will bring visiting scholars from outside. If you are not on our mailing list, then I advise that you put your name down and your email address, and we will send you notification of the lectures to come. But also you can visit a site's website, and you will find information about these lectures. This July, there is a Islamic schooling conference. It is the third Islamic schooling conference. If you're interested, please visit our website for more details. There is tea, coffee, and light refreshment outside, and you're all welcome to have some tea, some coffee, and refreshment. And of course, it is Isha time, so anyone who would like to do the Isha prayer, we will do it inshallah ta'ala in one of the rooms, perhaps in 10 minutes. Jazakumullah khair, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Thank you very much, and good night.
I was there looking for the 20 minutes.
I'm going to go to the next one.
your office.
Tell us.
Hi.